Have you ever taken a friend to a thing and then watch them get way too fucking drunk? And then they start doing all this way too drunk shit and you're the one that gets embarrassed even though you're not the one doing the shit and you have no control over it? It's like, you know, you brought them to the thing or maybe you didn't even bring them. Maybe they just, you know, met you at the thing, but now they're shit-faced and acting like an asshole and you're the one apologizing even though you're not doing anything wrong. In fact, you're probably the person most actively trying to stop them from doing whatever it is you're apologizing for, and still you feel responsible. All right, so maybe you haven't been through that. I have an analogous situation that might be more familiar to my American listeners. You ever have somebody from another country come visit this ridiculous Jesusville nation of ours? So yeah, okay, so my buddy Andy Wilson from the Merseyside Skeptics, was in the States for a couple of weeks, and he just so happened to wind up in Georgia. So I drove up to meet him in Atlanta because the state of Georgia is like a lazy person's apartment where only the front room is clean. So whenever you have company, you just don't let them walk down the hall and see what lies south of Atlanta. But of course, Atlanta's still Georgia and Georgia's still America. So as we walked around, I had this constant feeling like my country just got drunk and pissed itself at the wedding. Now, of course, by the time I met up with Andy, he'd already been in the States for a couple of weeks, so it was way too late for me to distract him from all the crazy shit, like, don't look at the money. So naturally, by the time I got there, he'd saved up a lot of questions for me. Now, some of them were the typical foreigner in America questions, like, you know, why do you people need so much cheese? Do you think we'll forget what country we're in if we don't see the flag 11 times per mile? Do you make all those bills the same size to intentionally fuck with the blind? But Andy's a skeptic and an atheist, so one of his questions hit a little closer to home than the others. See, throughout their drive, they'd been bouncing back and forth between different cities to see different friends and attractions. They'd actually driven through like Tennessee, Alabama, Georgia, and both Carolinas. And when you do that, there's a phenomenon that's almost impossible to miss. It's one that you see over and over again. You drive through a destitute town filled with ramshackle homes that should be condemned. You got boarded up storefronts, rusted cars on blocks littering the front lawns. And right in the middle of the city, you see this beautiful church that's perfectly maintained. And a few blocks down, you see another one. And then another one, and another one. And so the obvious question is, in a town with no money, who's paying for those churches? And I guess maybe Andy asked that hoping that I was going to explain some top-down structure in baptism that poured money into underperforming churches, or at the very least that there was some blatant violation of church-state separation that funneled federal tax dollars into them. But the real answer is, of course, the saddest possible one. The church is being funded by the destitute people that surround it. They're paying for the new stained glass windows in the church even while their own front window is broken, because Christians in this country still adhere to the medieval concept that the last thing that should go to shit in your town is the church. They believe that even when their own home is in dire need of repair, it's more important to see that God's house is in tip-top shape. But certainly, Andy argued, they couldn't be tithing enough to maintain those things, could they? And have any money left over to pay the preacher? But of course, the truth is even worse than that. They don't build the extensions with the tithing money. They steal that money from the dead people. Right? They convince their aging and sometimes senile congregants to maybe grease those heaven wheels a bit by leaving a sizable portion of their estate to the church. Now, you know, these estates might not be much. They're poor people, but, you know, maybe they've got a large plot of land in a town that nobody's buying land in. Don't worry, the municipal governments in this part of the country are always happy to take land off the hands of the churches at a better than fair price. So the end result, of course, is that more and more of the money winds up getting funneled into the least useful building in town. A building with a value that actually becomes more negative the more money you invest in it. And because those very same buildings starve the local government of land taxes and they get all those sweetheart deals, whether they're buying or selling land, they hamstring any more useful building that might take their place. But that's not the only way they're funded, of course. Many of them run businesses of various sorts. Say, a daycare right there in the church. Now, there may be other businesses in town offering daycare services, but those suckers are going to have to be certified and spend a bunch of money making sure there are no open cartons of lies sitting around, so they're never going to be able to compete with a church. Plus, the church is going to, you know, charge money for their service, but mostly rely on volunteer labor to do the job, so they've got a much wider profit margin. And speaking of volunteer labor, who do you think mows that big-ass lawn of theirs? You think they're paying somebody to do that? Hell, much of the actual maintenance and construction was done by volunteer labor. So even without all that funding, they'd clean up pretty enough to make Andy wonder how the hell it was possible. In other words, as much as I hated to admit it, demanding 10% of the income of destitute people on fixed incomes is the least heinous way they fund themselves.